Hello friends, after completing the female reproductive system topic, we will start with in the previous lecture we have studied about the internal genitalia, in which we have studied about the female reproductive system, the internal organs. Now here we are going to talk about the external genitalia. As we have described yesterday in the chart, that external genitalia composed of the secondary sexual organs, and it includes the external genitalia, and another one is mammary gland. So today we will be discussing about two main topics, that is external genitalia in female, and the another one is the mammary gland in the female. So now let us begin with the external genitalia. What is external genitalia? External genitalia are the organs which are located on the surface of the female's body associated with the reproductive system. So if we talk about in detail, the external genitalia mainly is composed of mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, then you can say clitoris, and next is the hymen. So this is what you can say is female external genitalia composed of. Now let us talk about the first one, that is known as mons pubis. Now what is this mons pubis? Mons pubis is located on the anterior portion, and it is made up of fatty tissue. Okay, it is made up of fatty tissues, and it is covered with a hairs and skin over it. So this is a fatty tissue cushion like structure that is covered with skin as well as hairs. So this is the first structure, and we call it as mons pubis. So this is the first, that is known as the mons pubis. Just beneath that, remember that first is mons pubis, beneath that is labia majora, and beneath that is labia minora. So you just need to remember, first is mons pubis, second is labia majora, and then comes the labia minora. So let us begin the second point, that is labia minora. So you can see that this is what you can call, this layer is what you can see is labia minora. So this labia minora are the two extended portion of mons pubis beneath the mons pubis. So labia minora are again paired fleshy folds of tissue, again covered with skin, okay, covered with skin. And where is it located? It is located beneath the mons pubis. You can say like that, it is located beneath mons pubis. Always remember that this does not have hair follicles. So you will write here one more point, that it lacks hair follicles. Okay, then comes the third. I'll just write it a bit down. The third one is labia minora. Okay, what is labia minora? Labia minora are also paired structures. Okay, that is beneath the labia majora. So this is the third one, this one. So we'll write about this. This is labia minora. It is located beneath, okay, it is inside, towards the inner side of the labia majora. So this too is labia majora, and inside this is labia minora. So we will write that it is located beneath labia majora. It is comparatively thin fold than the labia majora. Majora means larger structure, minora means smaller structure. So it is comparatively thin fold of tissue, okay, thin fold of tissue beneath the labia majora. So this is what you can call it as labia minora. Okay, then there is a small finger like structure, there is a small finger like structure, and this is what you call it as clitoris. So I'll describe clitoris over here. Now let us understand what is clitoris. Now you all can see that this structure over here is known as a clitoris. So what is clitoris? Clitoris is a thin, small projection, okay, above the vaginal opening. So this portion is what you can say is vaginal orifice, and this is urethral orifice. And over here, just above that, there is a thin, small projection-like structure, which you call it as clitoris. Clitoris is often referred to as a similar structure to that of penis. So you can call it as, it is something which is homologous, means kind of similar structure to penis, but it lacks any duct. So it does not have any duct inside that. So that is what you call it as. This is the clitoris. So this is the fourth point you need to remember. After that, now you can see that this is labia majora and this is labia minora. And what is this? So this is the opening, or you can say orifice. Now this is a urethral orifice. What do you mean by urethral orifice? Urethral orifice is a passage or an opening through which the urine comes out. So you can say that this is a urethral orifice, and through this what comes out? Urine is expelled out. So you can say that urine is excreted out from this opening. Whereas when you talk about this vaginal orifice, this serves for copulation, as well as you can say that the menstrual blood comes through this vaginal orifice. So this vaginal orifice serves for copulation, and you can say that menstrual bleeding. So here you are very much clear that the path of urine, okay, path of urine is completely different from the part from where the vaginal blood, the menstrual blood comes out. So this is totally different in female. Now, one more structure you can see I have explained over here is this fifth point, and the fifth point indicates hymen. Now, what is this hymen? Hymen is a mucosal fold. You can say that it is a mucosal, vascular mucosal fold. It is a perforated structure that surrounds the vaginal opening. Okay, so I'll write over here, it is a mucosal, means what? Made up of mucosa. Perforated, it can have pores inside it. So it is a perforated structure. Perforated ka matlab hota hai, it is having pores inside it, so that the whatever blood comes, blood can easily comes up. Okay, then mucosal perforated membrane. And yes, it is rich in blood supply, so it is a vascular one. Remember that. So I'll write the point that it is mucosal perforated. Perforated having pores, and you can say having blood supply. So you can also write it as a vascular membrane. It is really very thin and delicate. Let me tell you this. It is thin and delicate. So it is believed that during the first intercourse, it breaks down. But that is a myth, that it indicates virginity. So there is no, it is not a proper statement that justifies that the presence of intact hymen indicates virginity. So if we talk about hymen, you can say that hymen is a very thin, delicate membrane that generally is believed to be breaks during intercourse. It breaks during intercourse. But let me tell you that it does not indicate the virginity of that female. So I'll put a point over here. It does not indicate virginity of female. Why? Because it can even break during exercise, during any kind of physical exercise when it is undertaken by a female, like cycling. okay, like suddenly falling down or internal injury can even break this hymen. So it is not necessary that it indicates virginity. So hymen can break even by vigorous exercise cycling, internal injury. So there are various reasons because of which you can say that hymen can break. So it never ever indicates the virginity of a female. So that is a total myth that if hymen is intact, it says that the female is chaste and which is believed to be virgin. So there is no basically a proof. So just a quick revision towards the female external genitalia. It is basically comprising of five different parts. The first one is mons pubis, the interior one. Just below that lies paired folded structure, labia majora. Third is labia minora. Beneath the labia majora, inside it lies the labia minora. And labia majora and labia minora covers, or you can say bounds, the vaginal orifice. Then there is a small thin finger-like projection, that is what you call it as clitoris, that appears to be that like of penis. Okay, it is thin and small, but it does not have any duct or it does not have any opening. Okay, then what is the urethral orifice through which the urine comes out, and the next is the vaginal orifice through which the menstrual blood, and it acts as a copulatory passage. Further, hymen is what I have already described. So this is all about the external genitalia of female. After completing the external genitalia, let's begin with the next topic, that is the mammary gland. Now, mammary gland is also called as the secondary sex organ in female, which develops under the influence of the sex hormones at puberty. When you talk about the mammary gland, we know that all the mammals have got mammary gland, and the function of mammary gland is to feed the newborn baby so that it gets nourishment. Mammary gland is well developed in female, whereas in the male it is just for namesake only, means it is not functional. If we talk about the structure of mammary gland, they are exocrine gland. What do you mean by exocrine gland? They have got the ducts over here. So those glands which have got the ducts over here are known as exocrine gland. So ideally we call them as breast. Now when you talk about this paired exocrine gland, and actually it is a modified sweat gland. So during the course of evolution, in female the sweat glands got the sweat glands got modified into a structure called mammary gland. Further, what is the location of mammary gland? So mammary gland is located on the upper thoracic area, so in the thoracic region it is located, where it is above the ribs and supported by the muscles called pectoralis major muscle. It is covered with the skin, and towards its anterior side the skin becomes dark pinkish brown in color. And that dark pinkish brown colored on the breast or on the mammary gland is what you call it as areola. So this whole area which appears to be dark brown pink in color, we call it as areola. So this is dark pinkish brown in color. And its anterior side is called as nipple. Okay. Through which the milk, it is actually an opening through which the milk is sucked out. So ideally you can call it as it is a opening. So this is what I have drawn, is a skin. And beneath this there is a connective tissue that supports, that works like a frame, or that works like a supporting, like a cushion like structure, we can call it as, that is fat. So fat is providing a support to the mammary gland. Now ideally when you talk about mammary gland is divided into mammary lobes. Okay, so it is divided into mammary lobes. So almost there are 10 to 12 mammary lobes in each breast or in each mammary gland. So suppose if I'm drawing a mammary lobe, it would be one single lobe would be this way. This way. Now inside the mammary lobe, there are the small cell collection of the cells, and this is what you call it as mammary alveolus. So these are group of cells that secretes, we can say that produces and secretes, well right here first, produces and secretes milk. This is basically made up of cuboidal epithelium. So which cells are present over here? Cuboidal cells are present over here. So this is what you can call it as mammary lobe. In this mammary lobe, we will find some cells. And this group of cells are called mammary alveolus. So we call them as mammary alveolus. Furthermore, this will have a duct, branch duct. You can see this. So it will be having this kind of branch ducts. This. And this is known as the mammary duct. So from this comes out the mammary duct. So whatever milk is produced in this mammary alveolus is transported by this mammary duct. So you can say that here this mammary duct will transport the milk. This mammary duct further opens into a broad opening, we call it as mammary ampulla. Okay, so if I talk about this, let's say like this is a branch structure, so I have drawn it this way, sorry. Okay, so this is the branch structure, what you call it as mammary duct. And mammary duct opens into a broad structure. Here you can see this, and here I have drawn as this. This is called as mammary ampulla. Remember that whenever you talk about a swollen opening in biology, any swollen opening, it is termed to be ampulla. What is it called as? Ampulla. Okay, so here you can see that whatever milk is produced from here is transported over here, and here in mammary ampulla, you can say that milk is stored for certain period of time. And then this, so you can say that this is a broad opening or broad open duct. You can say broad open duct. Okay, where the milk which is produced is stored temporarily. So after ampulla, it comes the lactiferous duct. So what is this lactiferous duct? You can see that this is a straight tubule, and here it is shown over here. So this is the lactiferous duct. Now these lactiferous duct will, this is a passage for the milk to come out. So whenever the milk is sucked by the baby, it comes out through this, milk is secreted through this lactiferous duct. And where does this lactiferous duct opens? This lactiferous duct will open on the outer side, and this structure is what you call it as nipple. So the baby sucks the nipple, and the what we can say, the milk comes out from this. So ideally you need to remember the sequence of the mammary gland. You can say that mammary gland is having 15 to 20, remember it is 15 to 20 mammary lobes, which is further divided, which is further consisting of cells, which are called a group of cells together, what you call it as mammary alveolus, which produces milk and that stores milk inside it. It is when secreted, it goes to the mammary duct. Through that it enters into ampulla, through that it goes into the lactiferous duct, and through the nipple it is sucked out. And the brown pink area that surrounds the mammary gland is known as the areola. Remember that mammary gland is a modified sweat gland functional in female. So what is the function of mammary gland? The function of mammary gland is to produce and secretion of milk for the nourishment of child. So this is all about the mammary gland.